ரளம் புத்தகதே குத்தகதீங்கண்ண தம்தம்.
Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us on a Sunday morning for the sixth inquiry webinar. In this inquiry webinar series, we try to introduce you to the foundational concepts of inquiry and also show you how you can use them to answer some questions that you may have without necessarily referring to the internet or a textbook or asking someone. Great. Today's topic is experimental inquiry. Basically, we go into how we design experiments. And today, we have a situation with us. Zoya and Aryan bought two jasmine plants from a nursery. And Zoya, when the plants bloomed, Zoya's flowers turned out to be fragrant, and Aryan's flowers were not fragrant. Why did this happen? And how can an experiment help us figure out the answer to this question? So, Tara, why don't you tell us some more about this?
Oh, okay. So, you said that Zoya's flowers, jasmine flowers, were fragrant and Aryan's were not. The question is, what could have made this difference? So, Madhav, do you want to make a guess, an initial guess?
Well, meaning there could be various factors which change how fragrant things are, but maybe the difference in the amount of water they put on the flowers, on the plants.
Yeah. Sorry, before we go any further, I realized I forgot to introduce the people on the panel today. So, pardon me. We have with us Tara and Madhav. And they're going to help us figure this out some more. So, yeah. So, Madhav was saying something about water.
So one possible guess is that that one of them used less water than they should be using. And that's where the plants were less fragrant because of that, potentially.
I think that, what you're saying is... maybe one of them didn't use enough water, right?
Maybe one of them did not. Okay. Yeah.
So how much water? Well, I guess we'll have to think about roughly how much water they each put. Assume that one of them had less water than the other. And if that is really the case, then we have a hypothesis, right? If a jasmine plant doesn't get enough water, then its flowers won't be fragrant.
So that's if it is the case that one of them, say, Aryan used less water than Zoya, then this hypothesis could potentially explain this, right?
Okay, but if that is our hypothesis, how do we test the hypothesis?
Yeah, well, because one used less water than the other doesn't mean that it's necessarily the case that it's the water which causes this, right? Because, there could be many other factors and water could just be unimportant. So them being a girl and a boy, that's probably not a factor which matters, even though that's that is the difference, right? So, but water seems like a reasonable thing to consider. So let's...
Yes. If we start out with this particular hypothesis, that it is water that is relevant for the difference in fragrance, how do we determine whether it was water or not? How do we conduct an experiment? Now, this is where we have to design an experiment.
Right? This requires an experiment to determine whether it's water or not. Okay. So what do we do? We have two groups of plants. One of them...
We have to make sure that they are from the same mother plant.
Yes.
So we have to, because we want to keep all the other factors absolutely stable.
And
water, right? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So the point is, we want to vary the water, but keep everything else stable, right? Mm-hmm. So that we can say that it's only water which is different between these two groups of plants. So the one group of plant would have an inadequate amount of water, not enough water, while the other group of plants would have enough water, whatever that means, right? Okay, now what happens with that?
So what happens? Well, once the flowers have bloomed, what are the possible things that can happen? What are the situations that we might find? In other words, the question would be, what are the possible outcomes of our test? Right?
Yeah.
And yeah. So we have to figure out what the conclusions are that we draw from whatever the situation is.
Yes. Yeah. So one possibility is that if we have, if in both the groups, they turn out to be fragrant.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
So what's the conclusion? That's a possible outcome of the test, that both the groups are fragrant. So how would we take that? So what conclusion can we draw from that?
Well, obviously, if both groups are fragrant, then hypothesis one is wrong. It couldn't have been the water that made the difference to the fragrance. Right? So even without the water, the group that the flowers on the second on that group are fragrant. So yeah, that means hypothesis one is wrong.
Yeah, hypothesis one has to be wrong because in both cases they're fragrant. So clearly, water doesn't seem to have any impact on
The quantity of water. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, the quantity.
So what's another possibility? What's another possible outcome?
Both aren't fragrant.
If both of them are not fragrant, then we can't say anything about whether it's the water or not, right? Doesn't tell us anything.
Yeah, because if we can go up to the actual hypothesis, it might be, Aditi, can you scroll up to where the actual hypothesis was? It was...
That if the plants don't get...
Enough water, then its flowers will not be fragrant, right? It's not saying that if it gets enough water, its flowers will be fragrant. So that's the important thing to point out. So then in that situation, since the flowers are not fragrant, either way, this hypothesis is unrelated to that outcome.
Yeah. So it really doesn't tell us anything. That's...
That outcome doesn't tell us anything about the hypothesis.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Aditi, can you go
What's
back?
Another outcome?
The group where there is enough, where there's not enough water is fragrant, while the group where there is enough water is not fragrant.
So this goes completely against, the outcome goes against the hypothesis. So again, we can say that the hypothesis is wrong.
Yeah, because even though there's not enough water, the flowers are still fragrant, right?
The other way around.
Yeah.
Even with enough water, the flowers are not.
The flowers are not fragrant. Yeah.
Doesn't tell us. Yeah. Okay. Any other possible outcomes? Yeah. Well, actually, that's the opposite, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
That the flowers are fragrant when there is enough water, and the flowers are not fragrant when there's not enough.
And well, in this situation, having kept everything else constant, it has to be the water. So if this is the outcome, then hypothesis one is right.
Yeah.
Okay. So if the outcome is the last one, fourth one, then all is fine. We are right, the first hypothesis. But what if the outcome is the one of the first three? Either A or B or C, what do we do then?
Well, then we need to consider other factors and come up with other hypotheses in order to try and figure out why Aryan's plant was not fragrant while Zoya's plant was.
Okay. So I have a question before we go on. So from all this, can we sort of try to understand what the word hypothesis means? What is a hypothesis?
A hypothesis is an initial guess, an informed initial guess, we are picking one variable as a possible reason for the difference between the two sets of flowers. And we're checking to be, so we're stating a hypothesis as if this is the case, then this is the outcome. And we're using that. So the hypothesis is actually a guess that needs to be tested and confirmed.
Yeah, I think that's the easiest way. Just a guess, a conjecture, whatever, however you want to say it. Yeah, it's, I don't think it's important. I think that's good enough for intuition. We don't need to go more into that. Intuition is enough.
Okay. Yeah. So we've considered water as a possible factor, right? Another factor is sunlight.
Yeah, sure. Sunlight seems to be a reasonable factor.
Okay, so if then we have to have another hypothesis, we have to actually, it's a good idea to state the hypothesis explicitly, clearly, precisely, so that we can actually test it, right?
Yeah. So Aditi, let's go down to the hypothesis for, so the hypothesis is that the difference has to do with the amount of sunlight. I think the hypothesis is further down. There should be a written, okay.
So
hypothesis two is that if there's not enough sunlight, then the plant, then there's not enough fragrance. Right. There's no, the plants
if
are not
the plant fragrant. Doesn't get enough sunlight, then its flowers will not be fragrant. That's the way we would. So you start out with a guess and then you state it precisely in such a way that you can actually test it, right?
Yeah. So we haven't actually written out that hypothesis here. I thought we had, but okay, that's fine. So now how do we test this hypothesis?
So again, we go back to getting more plants and having two groups of them. One group which we make sure it's placed in a location, the plants are placed in a location where there's plenty of sunlight and get sunlight all day. And the other one where they're mostly in the shade.
Right? Okay.
And so, again, we leave them and see what the flowers are like. What are the possible outcomes?
Okay, so Tara, before we move on to actually working through this, I have a question. Why are we getting more plants? Why do we need some number of plants?
We don't have to if those plants are fine, but we don't know if... So one of the things we have to keep steady is what their history is, right?
But I mean, even keeping the history steady, why not just one plant? Why are we getting
we can get just one plant in each, but... if we have a larger number, we have a greater sample. And if we find that the results are identical across the sample, then then our conclusions are more reliable.
Yeah, because it could easily be the case that that there's just some random variation which we are not able to control at all in the case of one plant. There could be some, for instance, something just wrong with that one particular plant, which like when from its birth or something like that, which you can't do anything about. But that's why we get a sample. Okay. Then why do we separate the plants randomly into two sets? What's the importance of the randomness?
Well, because again, we could be selective. Suppose we take all the healthy ones and give them enough sunlight, and the unhealthy ones, you need to mix them. You have to make sure that they're the groups are kind of, they have similar properties. The sample, the two sets have to be similar.
Yeah. And randomness tries to achieve that.
Yes.
Yep, that's what the goal of making it random is. Okay. Okay, so now, once again, let's work through the outcomes of this hypothesis two, of the test, for the hypothesis, and then the conclusions which we arrive at. This is going to be very similar to what we just did earlier with the case of water, but let's work through it just. just for the sake of it. Okay. So outcome one, for both sets of plants, the flowers are fragrant. So once right. again, that means the hypothesis is false, right?
Yes. So the reason is even without enough sunlight, the ones that don't get enough sunlight, their flowers are fragrant. And so the difference between the two sets of flowers, the fragrant flowers and the non-fragrant flowers, couldn't be because of the amount of sunlight.
Right? Okay. So sunlight could maybe mean, no. Yeah. Sunlight doesn't seem to play a role if this is the outcome.
If that is the outcome. So now it's important to see that we're not saying this is the outcome. We're looking at possible outcomes, right?
Yeah.
Now you will see the actual outcome only if you do the experiment.
Yeah.
But we're saying when you do the experiment, what are the possible outcomes and what are the conclusions you can draw based on each outcome, depending on what the outcome is. Yeah? Okay.
Yeah. And that's an important thing to do before you actually go do the experiment. You want to see why you're, because this is the only way you figure out why you're doing that test, to see how the outcomes result in us actually testing the hypothesis, right? The important part is to have outcomes which actually test the hypothesis.
So again, to come back to what we're doing here, we're talking about the design of an experiment even before you actually do it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So that's that outcome that both sets of flowers are fragrant. What about then the potential outcome that both are not fragrant?
Yes. So exactly as in the case of water, here, regardless of whether they have enough sunlight or not, they're not fragrant. Again, this doesn't tell us anything about the hypothesis,
Okay. Then a third possible outcome is that the flowers are not fragrant when there's enough sunlight, but they are fragrant when there's not enough sunlight. The opposite of what we're looking
at. The outcome is exactly the opposite of what we expect, given the hypothesis. And so it's... obviously, hypothesis two is wrong because it makes wrong predictions. Prediction meaning, the consequence of the hypothesis. The hypothesis, you have the hypothesis and the outcome, and outcome is not what the hypothesis says it will be or it should be. And so it goes against the hypothesis and therefore it's wrong.
Yeah, in fact, in this case, it could even be that not enough sunlight, or that's a weird way to say it, but not enough sunlight is a good thing. It results in the flowers being fragrant.
Right.
Actually, that's one reason why actually this sentence should not be here. The amount of sunlight is irrelevant. It may not be. At least for this particular hypothesis, the amount of sunlight is irrelevant. In relation
but that's just the statement of the outcome. In that particular set, the plants didn't get enough sunlight, but the flowers are fragrant.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And then the last outcome is the one which seems to confirm our hypothesis, which is that the flowers are fragrant when there is enough sunlight and they are not fragrant when there's not enough sunlight. Right. Okay.
Okay. Do we want to pause for a minute and see if there are any questions, Madhav?
Let's do that. If Aditi, you have some quick questions.
So I'm going to stop sharing the screen for a while now. Mm-hmm. And we have a question from Ramesh who asks, could you please explain what a hypothesis is? I think we went into this a little bit. So we move on to the next question from Naren, who asks, should hypotheses only be binary? Did you hear that question?
Yeah, so you mean in the sense of having a yes or no answer? Well, you could have probabilistic hypotheses, which depends how you interpret them, but in some, you can interpret them as not having yes and no answers.
Mm-hmm. Really depends on the question, right?
Yeah. So today we're dealing with a very simple case, because this is meant to be an introductory session. So we're dealing with a case where it's much easier to understand how the outcomes relate to the conclusions. But of course, they're way more complicated situations.
Yeah. Also, I would like to request the audience members that if you have any questions based on what we did in today's session and generally about experiment design, please post them in the comments. All right. So with that, we have a question from Sheila Ditya, who says, it seems even before making any hypothesis, one needs some background information about the case. That is, one needs to start with a set of assumptions, which are the premises for making a guess. What do you have to say about it?
Yes, yeah. So you do have to have some idea of what the possible reasons for something that you're looking at might be, right? So in this particular case, you're talking about plants, and what are the factors that go into the health of a plant? Or the health of, well, yeah, the health of the plant. So what are the things that the plant needs? It needs nutrition, it needs sunlight, needs water, it needs, so for nutrition, it needs the right kind of soil. So, I mean, you have to think of what the possible factors are that could affect its health.
Yeah, it's because you're not just randomly picking, because you could put, so as I mentioned earlier, you could pick that Zoya is a girl and Arjun's a boy, and therefore that's a factor, but it's highly unlikely to be a factor there.
Or that you watered the plant with your right hand or with your left hand.
Versus your left hand. So there are various things which could, meaning potentially be explanatory, which we just don't even try to test, because it would be it seems like it's unrelated. There's no reason for us to think that it's related.
So there's a sense of what the plausible factors are, right? That you do need to have in order to come up with a hypothesis.
Yeah.
And in this case, they were water and sunlight.
That's the two we picked, but we could have picked soil. We could have picked various other things.
Yeah.
We could have picked pollution. Well, yeah. Right.
Do you want to take up one more question and then go in, or do you want to continue with the...
We'll take one more question.
Okay. Yeah. So the other question is from Belavan, who says, out of the many potential hypothesis candidates, how do we go about selecting one or a few to test?
Again, it's a sense of plausibility. What is the most likely? So first of all, you eliminate the ones that are weird, that could possibly not be, right? And among the others, which are the most likely ones? And there will be a certain degree of arbitrariness. So in this case, we picked water first and sunlight next. We could have gone the opposite way, would be equally reasonable.
It will also be that you're looking at what varied in your initial test, right? So in the initial test, that by that we mean between Zoya and Aryan, in that test, what were the things which varied? If soil was the same, then you just wouldn't think of soil at that point as being an explanatory factor. So it would be, yeah, so you would maybe do a small pilot or a couple of examples to test things out with, and then see what could be factors.
Okay. So we'll take on some more questions in a while. Now we'll proceed.
Yeah, so but in the meantime, so in what if in both our tests, we find that those first three outcomes are not, if we get one of those three outcomes in each test, then what do we do? Even before we go to other factors, there are at least two possibilities using these very factors. Is it the case that the plants need both sunlight and water, enough sunlight and enough water? Is that the case?
That could be the case. Yeah. It requires sunlight but less water. It requires less sunlight but water, and requires neither sunlight nor water, right? These are the potential.
Right. Now,
where that could go.
But with those potentials, we need to state hypotheses, right? With each of those.
Yeah.
So suppose it turns out that for the flowers to be fragrant, the plants need both enough water and enough sunlight.
Yeah.
So the hypothesis would be.
Even if one of them isn't there, so the implication of that, even if one of them is missing, then the flowers will not be fragrant.
Yes.
Right. So that's the hypothesis down there. Hypothesis 3. Can you scroll up so that it's not at the bottom of the screen?
The other scenario is where if they get either enough sunlight or enough water, then they will be fragrant.
Then, yeah. So it needs one, at least one of them, right? That could be an experiment, yeah. Okay, so now how do we design experiments to test hypothesis 3 and 4? We're not going to do that. Leave that for you guys.
We'll leave that there. If somebody has a comment and wants to try that,
Okay, that sounds good. Okay, so now how do we proceed from here?
So I have a question. When you were speaking about picking random plants, right, for doing the second round of experiments, is it enough to say that the plants should be random? What if I pick or should they be representative? Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so the assumption is that if your sample is large enough, then a random sample would be representative. Unless that would be the assumption. If the sample is large enough and random. Of course, if it's not large enough, then you would want to make sure it's representative if you can do that.
And it's also possible to start out with a pilot project, a pilot experiment, where you take some and you know that it's not a huge sample, but it's reasonable and it's reasonably random. And then you can go on to do the same, if depending on the outcome of your pilot, you can then go on to do it on a really large sample. That's also a possibility.
Yeah. So what sample is related to is the amount of variability that exists in the population. So you're picking a sample out of a population, and so take the example of a cup of coffee. If you wanted to know what a cup of coffee tastes, one spoonful or a sip should be enough to tell you how a cup of coffee tastes, because it's mixed well, et cetera, right? So if there's no very little variability there within that cup of coffee, so you can have a small sample which represents that entire thing. So you don't need a large sample there. While for something which is where there's a lot of different, lot of variables which exist and lot of values those variables take, in that case is where you're looking at larger samples.
And what I think we started talking about what sample and population. Could you just tell the audience a little bit about what that means?
So actually in this webinar, we're concerned mainly with the experiment design. So these are of course important things for that, but we don't want to lose the focus on experiment design and move on to a discussion of statistics. But just very quickly, population would be like, say, jasmine plants, and sample would be the ones you've picked in order to test.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then, so this would be jasmine plants. Suppose you want to extend your hypothesis to all plants, then it would be the population would be all plants. You can decide what the population is. Hmm.
Because that would be the goal eventually, right? So if we say, sure, this is true for some one of these hypotheses is true for jasmine plants, then you may be able to generalize it. And the value of generalizing is then that gives you a lot of more information, say if you're a gardener or whatever. So you can come to conclusions about a lot of different things.
Yeah, even in this case, you could decide that your population is jasmine plants in a particular city.
Yeah.
Then extend it by location. Mm-hmm. Extend it to other plants, small plants that have fragrant flowers. So it really depends on how what you decide your population is.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
And
so
the larger you make your population, at least for these sorts of simple hypotheses, you'll get less and less of the hypotheses being true.
Okay, so I guess we'll move on to some more questions from the audience now. Okay, so Naren has another question. He said, in your example, when the plant with sunlight did not give fragrant flowers, why was it said that sunlight is irrelevant? The hypothesis is wrong, but it was also stated that that sunlight was irrelevant. Should it not then be like presence of sunlight does not give fragrant flowers, assuming it is a binary hypothesis?
The point was that whether there was sunlight or there was no sunlight, enough sunlight and not enough sunlight, in both cases, the outcome was the same. Right? The flowers were not fragrant, which means that sunlight is not a relevant factor in the fragrance.
No, he's talking about the other case where it was the lack of sunlight when there was a lack of sunlight, it was fragrant. And when there was sunlight, it wasn't fragrant.
In that situation,
I think that was a mistake in the write-up. It was a little unclear. It shouldn't have said it's irrelevant.
No, but we said the hypothesis is wrong in that case.
The hypothesis is wrong. We also wrote that sunlight is irrelevant. That we shouldn't. That's a little misleading the way it was written.
Okay.
I think what we were trying to say is that variation in sunlight did not have an effect on.
No, in this case, it would, because less sunlight, it could potentially, because less sunlight resulted in more fragrance.
Right, right.
So sunlight may not be irrelevant. It may be irrelevant, but it may not be irrelevant.
I think just for the audience, in doing this last minute, we probably forgot to delete some copied and pasted material. I think that's probably the likely answer. Yes.
All right. Again, sorry, Dara.
Questions, Saditi?
Yes, there are more questions. I also want to request the audience to keep posting their questions. All right, we have a question from Parijat Banerjee. Is it always possible to vary your parameters continuously? If not, how do you vary them so as to obtain reliable observations? For example, less water, more water, how much water exactly?
We aren't looking to vary the parameters continuously in this case. You don't necessarily need, you could have discrete parameters, as in having a few values. So here the values were adequate water and non-adequate water. We had broken it up into two categories. Now, how we've done that is, that's not important to this particular for this particular webinar. We just have broken up the amount of water into two different categories.
Would it be all right if I tell a story, Aditi?
Yeah, of course.
This was a 10-year-old who told me yesterday that, he didn't know all of this. He was just talking about enough water and not enough, and enough sunlight and not enough sunlight. He said, you have two rows of seeds. You plant two rows of seeds, 10 in each row, and you give 10 units of water to one seed and 9 to the other, 8 to the other. We go down till 1. And for sunlight, you leave one without any shade, and the others you have one layer of a thin shade, maybe even plastic, 2 layers, 3 layers, 4 layers, 5 layers, and so on. And that will give you the gradient, the continuous result. And then you'll be able to decide what the best point is. But that was a search for something else. That is in order to judge what is adequate sunlight and adequate water, right?
Yeah.
Now, what we've done here is to assume the adequacy without really testing it. If you want to test for adequacy, you'll have to do what this child told you.
Yeah, so what counts as adequate and what counts as inadequate? We've just broken it up into two different values for the variable water, adequate and non-adequate.
Okay. So moving on to the next question, we have a question from Sheila Ditya again. In this example, can we test the hypotheses with just two plants? Will that be justified?
I don't know anything about plants, but it depends on the how variable different plants are, right? So are two jasmine plants exactly the same usually? I don't think so, but I don't know. But so if there is variability in jasmine plants, which I'm assuming there is, in that situation, you would need a larger sample. Yeah. Tara, I'm assuming jasmine plants vary from each other.
Absolutely. It's just like human beings vary from each other. And okay. It depends on what you are checking, whether the feature you're checking itself is variable or not. And the fragrance of jasmine plants, yes, it is variable. So which is why we specified that these are plants taken, the babies of the same plant, mother plant, right?
So then there'll be less difference between them, right?
Yeah. Unless conditions like water and sunlight and soil vary. So that's exactly what we have, that we get a chance to test. Yeah. Okay.
All right. Okay. So it looks like for now, there don't seem to be any more questions.
Okay.
So do we want to discuss the question that we left them with a little bit?
Yeah, so how would we have hypothesis 3 and hypothesis 4? And we're asking, how do we design experiments to test these two hypotheses?
Mm-hmm. So let's state hypothesis 3. Hypothesis 3 was you need adequate sunlight and adequate water. Right. Where is that? Can you scroll down?
I was just scrolling down. Yes.
Okay. So if a jasmine plant doesn't get enough water and enough sunlight, then its flowers will not be fragrant.
Yeah. So how would we go about designing something for that?
So how would you design an experiment to test?
So in this case, actually, it's quite straightforward, right? In this case, you just need two groups, one with enough water and enough sunlight, and the other with where you allow for variation, meaning, but you don't allow for both. Meaning, or you can break it up into four groups. That's up to you.
Yeah, if you're someone who is adventurous can actually take both hypotheses together and have four groups.
Yeah.
And do it in one.
Yeah. So those, what would those four groups be? One would be the same. So it would be adequate water and adequate sunlight, inadequate water and inadequate sunlight, adequate water and inadequate sunlight, and inadequate water and adequate sunlight.
Yeah. Right? So those would be your four groups.
So in those four groups, what are the potential outcomes? So I guess in the first group, So the first group let's take is adequate sunlight and adequate water. So what is what is the potential outcome there? That the plants had fragrance, right? Meaning, let's assume that the plants were fragrant. Then what does this tell us?
Well,
Tara. So if we found that with adequate water and adequate sunlight, the plants were fragrant, what does that tell us?
If the flowers are fragrant, then you would say that either plants need both, or they need water, and even if there's not enough sunlight, or they need sunlight even if there's not enough water. It could be any of those three.
Yeah. Right? And what if it was false? Like, meaning in the sense that this resulted in non-fragrant flowers.
If the flowers are non-fragrant, then we say that if they need, if they're non-fragrant, we say it's neither water nor sunlight that's really relevant.
Yeah, in fact, we can reject both hypothesis three and four.
Or that they need either sunlight or water, but not both. If they get both, then they won't be fragrant.
Yeah, that would be a hypothesis five, right? That if either one but not both. But this would reject hypothesis four if these resulted in non-fragrance. Okay, let's look at this other group, which would be inadequate water but adequate sunlight. Say the flowers were fragrant there.
Which one is this?
So in the top right.
Okay, top right. Inadequate water, adequate sunlight.
Yeah.
If the flowers are fragrant, then adequate sunlight is what matters.
Yeah. So, but it would reject So if it turns out to be non-fragrant, it doesn't reject hypothesis four, but it rejects hypothesis three.
Yes.
So I just want to say that here what we're doing is we're combining the two sort of variables and looking at the possible outcomes. So for example, in the first box, we saw what would our conclusion be if the flowers were fragrant and what would our conclusion be if the flowers were not fragrant. And then now we moved on to considering a mixture of adequate sunlight and inadequate water, and then exploring our conclusions given both those possible outcomes from the experiment. And one thing to note is that under all four of these conditions, you have both those possibilities where the flowers can be fragrant and the flowers cannot be fragrant. The real question when it comes to designing experiments is that given a possible outcome, what would you conclude from that?
And I think about the hypothesis.
About the hypothesis. And we have the two hypotheses up here. So I think what would be great is if, as we speak, you could make connections between which hypothesis is correct and which of these possibilities show which hypothesis to be correct. I mean, we're going to be discussing that also, but it would be great if you did that at your end as well.
And also some of these results also tell us something about hypotheses 1 and 2. So if you take this four-way, the four-box idea, you can use that for all four hypotheses. You're bringing them all together now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So you have the four possibilities.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, okay. So do we want to spend more time on this, or should we?
We want to spend more time, or do we want the audience to actually work through this and see if they can come up with something? That would be practical.
Yeah, I think that's probably the better way to go about it. Okay. So Aditi, are there any more questions?
Yeah, we have one more question, which is from Anish. He says, are all hypotheses verifiable through an experiment? As in, when do you run to do an experiment to test a hypothesis? So I think he's asking about what are the kinds of questions that an experiment is suited to answer.
Well, of course, there are certain things. So you can't use an experiment to answer a question about planets, right? Because you can't move them around or something, do something like that. But about jasmine plants, you can. So basically I don't know whether it's worth going into this in too much detail, but of course,
Actually, when we talk about experiments, we're talking here about experiment design, where you do something in the world outside to manipulate something and figure out the results. There are also experiments that you can do in your mind. You can think about something. What would happen if, right? And so obviously those kinds of experiments, for example, in philosophy, right? Madhav, you want to add something there?
No, I think that's relatively clear for now. I don't think there's, this is slightly tangential to the particular topic we are dealing with today. So.
And experiments, I guess to put it in brief, you do experiments where you have something that you can do something with. So Madhav mentioned planets. Obviously, we can't do anything with planets and the stars, celestial things. You can't do things with imaginary objects. You can't do something with your hands with imaginary objects. So there you wouldn't run to do an experiment, right? So.
Yeah, I think experiments are most suited to things that you can control or that you can vary, and then try out.
Yeah, in other situations, what you might do is look for what are called natural experiments, right? Mm-hmm. Things where there exists variation already, and you're just trying to look at how things differ. So, like when you're looking at planets, you want to test a hypothesis about planets, you can just look at naturally occurring variation and work through that. So you're not actually creating that variation, but the thought process around that is similar. How you think about the relation between the outcomes and the conclusions is similar.
Yeah, and it's the same also in terms of building your hypotheses or your conjectures before you start looking for the outcomes.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'll move on to the next question. Again, a question from Anish. Is there a point after which you stop searching for an alternative hypothesis? One can come up with many alternate hypotheses. Plants invest in getting fragrance to attract insects so as to reproduce.
That wouldn't explain variation over two different plants, right? So that hypothesis doesn't explain the outcome which we are expecting. Meaning you look, as we had said earlier, you're looking within your understanding of the sorts of things which can have an effect. Within those, you have some reasonable set of hypotheses. Yeah. Of course, things can get very complicated, right? You notice that with just two things, you have four potential combinations of them, each of which has two potential outcomes. As you increase your number of factors to 20 factors, that grows really fast. So
to go back to Anisha's question, if you're comparing a plant in a, let's say, in a high-rise flat and one in a garden, right, you would take insects coming in, coming to the plants as a possible factor. But not in the same environment, because there's no variability in that.
Yeah. All right, we hope that answers your question. We have a question from Naren. In this method of hypothesis testing, the effect of any variable or validation of hypothesis is based on whether the outcomes are seen in a large sample. In the sense, greater the positive occurrences, we can conclude that the hypothesis is valid or that the variable indeed affects the outcome. Can we question this? In other words, why do we need to base the conclusion on the number of occurrences? Just like samples were random, why not have the outcome? Why couldn't the outcome also be random? And if the outcome is random, how can the hypothesis be framed? I think, like, on first glance, it makes me feel like if your outcome is random, then perhaps the variable that you're testing for does not have an effect. So that's the conclusion that you can draw. Madhav,
yeah, Tara. Of course, we're making the assumption that if two plants had exactly the same conditions, plus exactly the same, like, genetics, etc., they would have the same outcome, right? That's an assumption that we're making. Hence, anything which varies from that, which negates that assumption, there's probably some there's a reason for why that's happening. Of course, that could be a reason which we won't be able to even think of. So in that case, none of the hypotheses we come up with will be important to test for it.
That's right. The point. We stop. And if none of our hypotheses work, then we stop. Until somebody sort of comes up with that thing that we hadn't noticed, the variable that we hadn't noticed before.
So. Okay. I think with that, we have one more question. I think this will be the last one we take because it's almost 12. We have a question from Sheila Aditya saying, regarding the conclusion drawn from the outcome, how does one test if the conclusion is strong or weak?
I'm not sure what that means, but are you saying something like, so say for instance, you had two two samples of things where you varied water. You said one with inadequate water and one with adequate water. And within each of those, there wasn't complete uniformity. We were assuming at this point there was complete uniformity. We were dealing with a very simple situation. But say 90% of plants had fragrance, not 100% in one of the groups. So then, of course, that's then not as conclusive as if all of them had more fragrance. It's not as conclusive as if 50%, it's more conclusive than if 50% had fragrance. I'm not sure if that's what the question was aiming at.
That is what random meant in this context. Yeah, I wasn't sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think it's time for us to wrap this session up. I want to say that in this session, what we were covering are the foundational concepts that go into designing an experiment. You may have noticed that we didn't go very deep into the specific sort of strategies or mechanisms with respect to, say, statistics or experiment design in terms of what kind of sample you pick and all of that, but the process of experiment design as a broad idea. This is because you could read up on statistics or stuff like that separately, but what we're trying to do is give you those foundational concepts.
Yeah, so I'd just like to add that this is useful for people, for instance, designing surveys. When you have a survey with potential outcomes, people pick, say you had a question with the answer yes and no, and 70% of people picked yes and 30% of people picked no. What's the conclusion that you would draw from that? You should know before you send that survey out what conclusion you would draw from different outcomes of a survey.
Yeah, and the other thing I think we were doing was also, what are the kinds of questions that you ask when you're doing this? How do you phrase those questions and so on? So,
right. And I think all the inquiry webinar series, all the webinars in the series focus on these kinds of things. Today we went into designing experiments, which is a part of scientific inquiry. There are other webinars where we've gone into the reasoning required to explore ethics, to mathematical inquiry, and so on. So do stay tuned on all our social media channels for further updates on when we do these kinds of webinars. We're planning to do them once a month. So do keep an eye out. And another thing is that if you liked this webinar, then you'll also like our podcast, which is called Thinking Like X, and in which we talk to different people from different professional backgrounds about how they think and what it means to think like a certain professional. So, for example, our latest episode is with a chef, Suvir Saran, who is a Michelin star chef. And we've spoken to him about what it means to think like a chef. And that.
Yeah, so you'll find the podcast at think.education/TLX, Thinking Like X. And you'll also find it on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, et cetera, et cetera. So please subscribe on whichever podcast app you use. You might find it useful.
And finally, of course, please send us your feedback about what you thought about this webinar, about the podcast, and about other materials that you can find on our website. We find your feedback extremely valuable in helping us learn as well. So do write to us at contact@think.education, or you can message us on any of our various social media platforms.
One last thing, Madhav. We want to talk about the YouTube.
The stream. Oh, so today we did do a trial YouTube stream for this. So this was streamed to YouTube as well. I don't know how well it worked out because I was trying to do it while being in the webinar. So I'm going to take a look at it and hopefully I want to be able to stream to YouTube as well from next time properly, so that we are. A lot of people complained about Facebook. As not wanting to be on Facebook, so which I understand. So we'll try and get something on YouTube.
Okay. So we'll try to stream the following webinars on YouTube as well.
Yeah. So no promises yet till I take a look at the...
Yeah, we said we'll try. Okay. All right. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great Sunday and we'll see you soon. I think